1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks,
yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. The brutal fall season is half over. So far, the fleet has suffered injuries, close calls, and violent storms. But with the big weather comes big fish.
Nice fish.
Holy man.
Yeah, baby.
Now, life is on the line as the search for swords continues. Miles from shore, Captain Scotty Drabinowitz and the Eagle Eye 2 are starting their 32nd day at sea.
We're gonna try to plug this boat this trip, but we want to sit low in the water.
The hold is stuffed with 35,000 pounds of swordfish. But Scotty's not going anywhere until the fishing dies out. And that doesn't look like it'll happen anytime soon.
Come on, buddy, get your head up in the air.
Got a hold of Ben.
Pull it in.
Come on!
Wow! Watch these boys pull in that nice 250-pounder.
That's a $1,000 sword.
40 some odd centimeters, nice fish.
Nice. See, we got another one now.
There he comes, from the pup.
Then up comes a tuna, per pound worth three times more than swordfish.
There you go.
Tuna,
tuna, tuna.
A big-eyed tuna like this will fetch over $2,000. And the fish just keep coming.
One, two, three.
Never seen anything like it in my life.
What's that?
Fascinating. Crew's working just like a well-oiled machine.
Fish, good price, probably maybe $6.50 or more.
Yeah, a little feisty.
Down in the hole.
It's looking nice down there. Fish, 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 and more fish. That's what we want to see.
That's 13,000 pounds of fish in one shift.
Haulback is complete. That's a nice looking fish right there. That's a nice big eye.
Now they'll pack their paycheck in saltwater ice.
Talk to me.
It's a crucial job. Do it wrong, and the value will plummet. The ice is made on board from seawater. It's colder than freshwater ice and keeps the fish at the perfect temperature, just a degree above freezing.
Ready?
Yeah.
That's all fish up in there. It's a good thing.
Nice fish today. And the hole is filling up down there. Keeps going like this for a couple of days. I don't know where we're gonna put the fish.
Miles to the northwest, Captain Linda Greenlaw and the Seahawk are steaming into Bay Bulls, Newfoundland to offload their catch.
I wish that we'd had the opportunity to finish our sets and put a good trip aboard. Not my decision, not my call.
48 hours ago, Linda was on the fish. But the Seahawk's owner ordered her in to hit the high market price, despite having less than 20,000 pounds on board.
I hope that the crew will hang in and make another trip.
Linda's fear of losing her crew is real. A small paycheck could be the final straw after a trip of breakdowns, bad luck, and pain.
It seems like everything that could go wrong did go wrong. It's just amazing. I just want this to end.
There's always been a concern, you know, after one of these trips, when you go to the dock, that, you know, you're gonna lose some crew. They're just not ready to make another trip for a variety of reasons, and it's not unusual for someone to, you know, step out.
And deckhand Dave Hiltz has already tried to quit.
I'm done, that's it. HE double hockey sticks.
The socks.
Now, Linda's hoping to offload fast and get back out to sea before anyone decides to leave.
Okay.
Can't wait to see what we end up with.
Okay, it's fine. Go up.
The swords are pulled out of the hold, weighed, and stacked on a truck for delivery to fish markets on the East Coast.
Okay.
Got a couple of real horses down here that I'm very anxious to see how much they weigh. So, got my fingers crossed.
When Scotty offloaded, his biggest fish weighed 441 pounds. If Linda has a heavier fish, Scotty owes her dinner.
And that is a big fish. Big fish.
The huge fish is 10 pounds under Scotty's record.
That's not the big one.
Good.
But Linda has one more chance.
Here comes the big one. That's a size large.
At 438 pounds, it's big, but not big enough.
Arr, that was our last hope, that fish right there. We do have another trip. We have another chance. So we ended up with 19,400. So that's always nice to have a little bit better weight than you think you're gonna have. It's better than going the other way.
Almost 20,000 pounds of fish could be worth $100,000. That's about $5,000 for each deckhand. But just as Linda feared, the strain of the trip has taken its toll.
Yeah, it sucks. I'm ready to get out of here, you know what I mean?
Mike Machado is leaving the Seahawk.
I'm flying out tomorrow at 9 o'clock. I'll be in Boston around 2:30. And that's that.
Now, Linda's a man down, and the fall season clock is ticking. 300 miles to the south is the Big Eye under Captain Chris Chompers Hansen.
All right, let's go. Got fish to pack, got a tank to pump out. Come on, we got time to mess around. Wake up.
It's 4 a.m. of the 12th day of the trip, and Chompers is ready to start work. The crew's been asleep for less than 2 hours. The bait freezer has flooded.
The hat's not getting shut, or maybe it needs to be tightened, I don't know. I weren't back here. Last time I opened it, it was dark.
After a poor start, Chompers has finally turned his trip around and has close to 14,000 pounds of fish in the hole. But this owner-operator is deep in the hole, and when he feels the stress, so does his crew.
Look at me!
Yeah.
Get the hook out of it like I told you. Take the hook out!
Look, you cannot wind these on here like. See how these are neat, Matt? You can't do that.
Chompers needs to get the water out before hauling the gear, or $2,000 worth of bait will spoil.
Matt's been down there for 30 minutes. I could have probably did it in 10.
But that deep in squid juice.
Chompers decides the best way to get a job done is to do it yourself.
I don't like losing 75 cent a pound bait. If you worry about your up there, get up there. Go up there. Get, that's your half. Stay over there.
As usual, the crew's not moving fast enough for the captain.
No quarter, no mercy.
Hey!
Yo!
Come here! Trash.
Hey, when you got good people, you gotta know how to treat them, know how to keep them around.
With the freezer finally clear, Chompers can start his seventh haul back. Soon, it's business as usual on the Big Eye.
He's over there in Woody World. They should have a damn ride at Disneyland called Woody World.
He's a little gripey, but that's an everyday thing with him. One thing about it, you never complain about it out here, because you're really asking for it if you do. Everything's going fine other than we need some more fish. Come on.
A 1,000 miles from the U.S., the Seahawk and Captain Linda Greenlaw are stuck in Bay Bulls, Newfoundland. After the Seahawk's brutal start of the season, deckhand Mike Machado quit.
Machado's not going on the next trip with us. A little bit of a surprise, you know, last minute. Machado doesn't really have any interest in going on this trip. So, you know, it hurts that someone's leaving, but, you know, we will persevere.
I'm sad that he's not going to finish the trip, but we have to go on. You know, I don't feel, you know, there's nothing I can do about it, really.
It just sucks, but, I mean, I respect his decision, and everyone has to make their own decision.
Now, Linda has to find a new deckhand before the Seahawk can leave the dock.
It's really short notice to say, can you get on the next plane to Newfoundland? It's not like flying to Boston. We're sitting here. Machado quit. No, I'm not kidding you. You get on a flight maybe tonight or tomorrow and get here tomorrow.
For Mike, who is no longer going now.
Well, you'll be reimbursed for it.
Don't worry about it. It was short notice. I'll give you a call a little bit later when things simmer down a little bit.
Check it out and then give me a call back.
That's no big deal. You get reimbursed for that.
All right, thanks, man. Bye.
Okay. Yes? Yes. Okay, bring 2 pair of boots, bring your oil gear, bring whatever you can fit in 1 sea bag and a backpack or whatever. All right, good deal.
After 6 hours and dozens of phone calls, Linda's finally found a new deckhand.
Thanks, Nate. Talk to you later. Bye. Okay, you can be here tomorrow night, 10:39, so we'll just leave the next morning.
Now Linda has to wait for the new guy to arrive. The season's ticking away. Every day of lost fishing is money out of their pockets. 1,200 miles to the southeast, Captain Chris Clem has the Francis Ann docked in its home port of Barnegat Light, New Jersey. On the last trip, the crew realized Greenhorn Ben wasn't cut out for fishing.
Ben, you can't stand around and just stare at them, guys. It's the same thing, every fish, box hook, gaff.
He is probably the worst person I've ever dealt with on this boat.
He's still gonna be one of my best friends, but he ain't a fisherman, that's for sure.
I don't have anything good to say about him. I'm sure he's a nice kid, but commercial fishing just isn't his forte, so.
Well, yeah, why don't you come down and, yeah, we'll talk some more and.
Now, the Francis Ann's owner, Rick Mears, has found a new greenhorn.
Never been fishing before, but he wants to try it. How's it going, Dave?
How you doing?
Rick from the Francis Ann.
I'm a plumber by trade. That's what I do for a living. And I've been out of work. Building's been slow. And that's why I came down here looking for this job.
greenhorns have to earn the respect of the crew. The Francis Ann's been burned once this season, so Dave faces an uphill battle.
I'm a little nervous about everything, but for the most part, I'm really excited.
My first impressions of the newbie, we're screwed.
Guys got everything, gloves, slickers, cutters, smokes. Where's Lemmy? All clear!
Go ahead, Chart!
This time of the year could get really rough out there, I know that. Never been that far out on a boat before. So there is a little bit of nervousness in me, but for the most part, I'm really excited.
Out of options, this greenhorn has a lot to prove. ...1,300 miles from home, the Eagle Eye 2 has been at sea for just under 3 weeks. The 90-foot boat has moved into cold water.
Shark! Big one!
Coming!
And cold water means worthless blue sharks.
When their tail comes out of the water, it just kind of flips back and forth like a puppy tail. I think that's why they call them blue dogs.
The blue dogs are worth nothing to the crew, but they're exactly why biologist Lisa Neatenson's on board. Each shark that hits the deck is measured, injected, and tagged.
We're sword fishermen, but today we're acting as blue dog fishermen.
Come on, Lisa, keep up.
This blue dog is number 600, but what Lisa really wants is a big mako shark to attach a high-tech satellite tag to.
Oh, they're coming like crazy now.
But all she's seeing is blue dogs.
Oh, shark in the water!
Finally, a mako. These sharks are some of the strongest, fastest killers in the sea. And unlike blue sharks, they can be caught and sold. But it's this shark's lucky day. He gets a satellite tag and is spared for research.
Come up, there she goes.
I love makos, they're so exciting.
Strong fish, very strong fish, a lot of makos.
What I do is really dangerous work, but I really love it. It's kind of perceived as crazy because it's sharks, live sharks on deck and all, but it's awesome and it's really rewarding, so.
It's been a great day for Lisa's research, but a bad day for sword fishing.
Lots of sharks, gonna be a long day today, long day.
...400 miles offshore, the Francis Ann is back on the fishing grounds for the final trip of the fall season.
I didn't see him get sick. Seems all right.
Captain Chris Clem is impressed that his new greenhorn hasn't thrown up yet.
I think if he was gonna get sick, he would've gotten sick already, that's for sure. So far, so good, but we haven't started fishing yet. Time to get back to business.
It's Dave's first set out, and all eyes are on him.
How you doing, Dave?
Seems pretty ambitious, but like I said, that can change in a drop of a hat.
Dave's in charge of setting up the buoys that keep the mainline afloat. The Francis Ann will set 40 miles of line and 1,000 hooks before cutting the gear free.
This, whatever we got on the boat is going out. Go big or go home first night.
You're already doing way better than Ben.
It's actually not as bad as I thought it was going to be. I know I'm going to be sore tomorrow, though.
Hopefully it keeps it up and might actually be pretty good for his first trip.
I'm really digging the new guy. I really like the new guy. Yeah, hopefully everything works out. It'll make our trip a lot easier. It's only the first day yet. I'm not counting my chickens yet.
350 miles from Newfoundland, the Big Eye is about to start their eighth haul back. Captain Chris Chomper's mission to fill his boat at any cost has turned his crew against him.
Nah, we ain't had no mutiny, really. No mutiny on the Big Eye. But after pushing them as hard as I did yesterday, and then turning around and setting out last night, and now not catching nothing today, I might just want to start looking over my shoulder. Well, I will be tied up before the night's out.
To fire up the crew, Chompers calls a pre-haul pep talk.
All right, boys, last hurrah. We're gonna do this as fast as we can. We ain't slacking up. This is the Big Eye, so balls out.
Captain Blight, sir.
All right, well, I gotta live up my reputation. Let's go.
A few hooks into the set, and Chompers feels a big sword on the line.
That's what I think it is. Marker!
Marker!
Hold on now, you got something there.
Yeah, he's a little pill.
Watch that pill.
It's a triple marker and could be worth over $1,500.
Never catch big ones like that unless you go to the Grand Banks.
With fish on the deck, morale is at an all-time high.
Woo! Yeah, Big Eye's got the best crew it's ever had right now. Oh, sword. Woo-hoo! Couple nice fish. Makes it all worthwhile.
Miles offshore, Captain Chris Clem and the Francis Ann are hauling their first set. There's a sword on the line. But the sharks have gotten to it first. And it's not the only casualty.
Shark ate the hook, ate my damn fish.
Heads up, heads up.
Another Mako, let's get this one, please. Heads up, heads up. Done. What do we got left?
2 seconds.
With this 6-foot Mako out of the water, maybe the rest of the haul will be intact.
Oh, I got the sword.
But a few hooks later, a 10-foot dusky shark.
Big eater.
Unlike the Mako, this dusky has no commercial value. They cut it loose.
Clear! Now hold on, hold on, hold on. Hold up. What's up, man? Talk to me.
In its battle to survive, the dusky shark dragged a buoy rope into the prop.
Just take the gaff out.
The propeller is now jammed and the boat is drifting in shark-infested waters. Deckhand Lemmy will have to risk the deadly waters.
I'm going swimming. The rope will stall out the engine, so got
gotta get that clear somehow. I either gotta cut it or try to untie it. Now you wanna do is try to get the rope or?
Absolutely, I'm all worried about the fish getting the rope. Engine.
Roger.
End of it going.
Can't really stay, hold on.
Okay.
It's like knotted up.
All right.
Want this?
Yep. Hold that tight.
Stay. Careful. Just think.
Lemmy's gamble paid off, and right away, there's something big on the line.
Got it.
Blue dog.
Big tiger shark. Right after I got out of the water.
You know, definitely makes you nervous.
Just got out of the water 5 minutes ago. Now we catch a 10-foot tiger shark.
It's a chilling reminder of what lies beneath. Bay Bulls, Newfoundland. After a 24-hour wait, Captain Linda Greenlaw finally has a new deckhand. Sword fishing virgin Nate Clark. 22-year-old Nate is a coastal lobsterman from Maine and a neighbor of Linda and Dave's.
I know Dave and Linda really well. On the lobster boat, we were hauling traps, and we got a call over the CB that Linda wanted me to come, and we ran right back into home so I could get packed and come in. It was real quick. I was on the plane the next day, so.
Linda will pull anchor at first light. Not soon enough for the beleaguered captain.
It is very important for the Seahawk to leave the dock before anybody else has some serious thoughts about not going.
Linda's season stalled when deckhand Mike Machado quit.
Yeah, it sucks. I'm ready to get out of here, you know what I mean?
As the Seahawk gets ready to depart, Mike's down the road, drowning his sorrows.
I hate to bail on him, like I said earlier, Kenny. I feel like I'm letting my friends down and being a little bent and down. But somebody had to throw the towel and let people know this is rough stuff.
His drinking partner is Kenny Puttister, whose season ended when he broke his wrist.
Whoa!
That's not good, buddy.
Anybody that goes sword fishing is king of the hill. It's the ultimate fishing. This is the toughest fishing. And I even hate to say it because I love like them Barron Sea boys and stuff. And as tough as them boys are, they ain't nothing tougher than sword fishing. It's real gnarly stuff.
At dawn, the Seahawk edges away from the dock.
See you out there, man.
Ahead, a 36-hour steam to begin their final trip of the season.
Feels good. Feels good to get back out, yes.
We can pull these in, Nate?
Yep.
Nate better be ready. The late fall storms punish the boats and crews brave enough to stick around.
It's getting cold. What the hell are we doing?
We're not gonna have good weather. I'm just hoping it's fishable.
Leaving the protection of the harbor, the Seahawk turns southeast straight into a classic North Atlantic gale.
Never thought I'd have the experience of being on a boat that Linda was captain. This isn't anything like Maine, to tell you the truth. I'm used to fishing farthest, 3 miles offshore, so this is gonna be a whole nother trip for me.
This is a real quick introduction for Nate to Grand Banks weather. And the minute we leave the dock, sort of getting tossed around. I hope we get to show him some good weather too, so he doesn't think it's like this all the time.
You know, I knew it was gonna be rough. I knew I was gonna have to get used to the weather and all that, but I wasn't gonna turn down the opportunity. It's a different trip coming this far out. I never thought I'd see waves this big, especially doing lobster fishing. We would never come out in this. You gotta be a little crazy, I guess, to do it. Come out, you know, 500, 600 miles away from shore, and it's definitely a different breed of fishermen, that's for sure.
A 1,000 miles from the U.S., Captain Chomper's gamble on the Grand Banks is paying off.
Are you a wimp? Are you scared of weather? You better stay home. You ain't scared of weather. You ain't scared to get your kicked. You ain't scared to work hard. Come on.
With 10 tons of fish already in his hold, Chompers took a risk last night and set his gear in colder water.
And that's what I did. I went down to cold water like I didn't care.
The crew is optimistic. Fish in the hold has improved morale.
Well, we're going hunting for those fish out there. Yeah, I could smell them. Oh, those green American dollars. Oh, yeah, yeah, smell good, smell good.
Usually, the cold water is filled with sharks, but not today.
Swordfish, big swordfish.
That's a straight bill right there.
One, two, three, up.
Yeah, baby.
Rock on. Yeah. Once again, my gamble paid off. Just that cold water.
Get the gaff, come on.
Hook after hook brings big fish onto the deck.
Oh, yeah. Woo, baby. Big old sword, sword, swordfish.
But then, their luck really turns.
What do you pay attention to? Pay attention to me, damn it. That's right, bring it on over here. Bring the rope. Oh, watch. Oh. Bring that rope over here. Pass it to Weeks. Tie it off on that cleat down there.
It's a Grand Banks giant.
Yeah,
this is a better one, though.
Let's hold him right there. Slack that drum off.
Woo, baby.
Yeah, I don't know. Come on over here. Help me pull on this rope. That's a pretty picture right there. Woo! No.
The 500-pound swordfish could be worth $2,000.
It's a big disaver, but it nearly take our life to bring it in the boat.
He's the biggest one we got, I think.
We ain't shacking that one. That one fish make everybody smile on the whole boat. Patience, persistence, aggravation, when will they get that all that. Huh? And there we go.
Hello.
That one fish.
When will they get that?
With one last set still to go, it looks like the underdogs are coming out on top.
God bless Big Eye!
30 miles to the northeast, Captain Scotty and the Eagle Eye 2 have been at sea a marathon 5 weeks.
We all right. We'll be done soon enough. I'll be home, and I'm staying there.
Hey, sweetie. Good to you, and I love you so much.
I love you, too.
I talked to my girlfriend today. I've been gone about 6 months now, and she's wanting me home, and I want to be home.
They're almost out of bait and food, which means they should be heading home. But there's a reason Scotty is one of the fleet's top dogs.
Hey, everybody get to the table here. We got a meeting to have here. Stand by.
What's that meeting?
Yeah.
In case you guys haven't already figured it out, we're gonna stretch the trip out a little bit. I'm probably gonna make another 10 more sets. So the Seahawks gonna be bringing us some bait. So we'll have them bring us some food supplies as well. Hopefully we stuff this boat. It'll be a killer trip if we can do it. That's gonna be the game plan.
The extended trip will be the longest of any of their careers.
I don't wanna be out here for another 10 sets, but we have to be out here. It's a long time to be cooped up on this boat, I'll tell you that. It's a long time.
Already exhausted, this will push the crew beyond their limits. But it could be the biggest paycheck of their lives. After steaming through a storm for the last 2 days, Captain Linda Greenlaw and the Seahawk have arrived for a rendezvous with the Eagle Eye 2.
One of the first things on our agenda and priority list is to deliver some things to Scotty.
Need a hand down there?
Linda has enough extra food and bait to keep the Eagle Eye 2 fishing for the last 2 weeks of the season.
You're driving this way and we're drifting that way, so.
Yep, I see you on the radar here.
Start coming right at you, over.
Very good.
We'll see you in a bit, over.
Wonderful.
Alrighty, we'll be standing by.
Okay, thanks for all that, Scotty. Standing by.
I just called Linda just to let her know our position so she can start making the proper adjustments and getting closer to us. And boom, we can get this transfer over and done with.
We'll get some bait, some food from Mr. Seahawk. Mrs. Seahawk, sorry.
Even for these experienced captains, it's a risky maneuver. A collision could damage or even sink one of the boats.
Normally when you go stern to stern, one boat just lays two. Will it be this one to let him do the maneuvering around us?
It's hard. The Seahawks really drifting different than we are. So it's a lot of jockeying around.
Hopefully Linda knows what she's doing over there. She can drive a boat. Hope she didn't forget how to do that too. Oh, I like you, Linda. You know, you're a nice lady and all, but you had a hard trip, had a hard start. Don't forget how to drive that boat. I don't want to go swimming today.
They have like a big bucket, I guess, that we can pass back and forth between the two boats on a line and put stuff in it. There's got to be 70 or 100 boxes of bait there, so it's a lot of pulling back and forth. Cigarettes and food. Definitely they're looking for the cigarettes and the food. They're not happy to see the bait, believe me. It's this point in the trip.
When is this trip gonna end? Not soon enough. We're all just ready to get in.
The transfer takes less than an hour. With the fall season clock ticking, every day of lost fishing is money down the drain.
That's it.
They won't let me off here. They won't let me go.
Nobody leaves. It's like the Hotel California.
Right? We're all stuck here.
Thanks a bunch. I think.
Good luck, guys. We'll see you guys on the land.
750 miles to the southwest, Captain Chris Clem and the Frances Ann are struggling to find the fish.
Cluster right there. I don't know what's going on. All the gear sunk. It's coming up in big friggin' piles. Not happy at all right now. I mean, that's three sections to go. Start catching a few fish.
And to make matters worse,
that's my boss. Hey, boss.
A half mile off the starboard side is the fishing boat, the Monica. On board is Rick Mears, owner of the Frances Ann.
I know he's right there, but I'm not looking at him.
He's making money running that, and he's making money by what we catch here, so we're all doing just fine.
Dave, the newest member of the crew, is learning fast, but he's still a greenhorn. A 5-pound sash weight just missed Dave.
You all right? I'm trying to miss my face, but I cut my
The steel weight shaped like a missile and used to help weigh down the main line. It could have easily shattered Dave's skull or killed him.
Luckily, I moved out of way in time and nobody got hurt too bad, so it's a good thing.
There's too much going on.
The boss watching, no fish, and Dave nearly getting his head knocked off. But then a change in luck.
Oh boy, what's this?
There's something huge on the line, and the crew better not lose it in front of their boss. The 500-pound big-eye tuna, also called an ahi, could be worth $10,000 when it hits the market. The tuna's too much for the crew, so Chris scrambles for the winch.
But listen to me, as I bring up weight on this, don't stand in front of that hook.
If the hook pulls out, it could rip someone open.
One, two, three.
The big eye tuna has not only saved the day for Chris, it's made the greenhorn's day too.
A lot of stuff's going on today. A lot of heads up, you know. Big fish. This is what I've been waiting for. This is fun. I've never seen fish this big, and we're pulling them in and making money off of it. Doing this. This is awesome.
It's original.